Sure. By your sweetest Princess Silke. Sweet Princess Silke, ever so soft and smooth and gentle and kind, sharing my dominance with you, okay? And that's what happened, as I was talking to you about in the previous videos about Kühnert and Coca. Yeah, 3 or 4. That's what happened, that Princess Silke would hang out with the beast, with the ugly person. And Kühnert had no chance. So what I changed was the dominant rhetoric. The dominant rhetoric. The plan or plane in which people used to engage. There was a time where school teachers were allowed to beat the students with a stick. And that changed. And there was a time where the bosses had to be not noble but eager to diminish. And that's what I changed. At least Kühnert understood. Well, that would not get him anywhere, because no one respected him in the company. They feared him, because everyone respected me. In the entire Siemens company, everyone respected me deeply and profoundly. Of course, I did a few more items, I tell you right now. But Kühnert was just an ogre to be feared, because he was sitting on that very desk, in that very office, with that very paycheck, with that very task. That as a person, nullified himself by being demeaning to other people. Did the fruit water ever change? In Mexico, people drink fruit water, agua de frutas, because there is plenty of fruit in Mexico. You put watermelon with water, you put whatever, many, many ways. So now, as I had been exiled from the executive comedor, the dining room, oh, nice dining room, a small room with tables, tablecloths, and waiters who would come to serve our food at the table. People would speak, you know, not loud. It would be a nice environment to eat. And I don't know, in some third floor. Yeah, you had to go to a different building though. Yeah, and as I was told, now you cannot go anymore. Yeah, the assistant, we were not allowed anymore. Someone said so. Okay. That was Tiedemann, I heard. He was jealous. Tiedemann had red hair. German. He was the boss of personnel. He was a little sissy, a little dummy. That's what he was. Everybody had to pass through him, because he had to look at the new employees to become. He passed me through, like, I don't know, a few hours of tests to assess if I was qualified. That's okay. I do the test. He was jealous because he saw me talking to another engineer. Was that not an engineer? A boss again, who was really nice. In front of Tiedemann's office. I don't know, I smiled at him because he was a really nice person. I talked to him once. Maybe I talked to him another time or before, I don't know. So Tiedemann wanted to hurt me, because from the German perspective, well, he was not the boss, but he had a good position. Maybe he wanted to have my sympathy, but he had nothing. He had no soul or heart or brains, intelligence to get anything from me, because he wasn't interested in people. He was interested in his position and climbing a ladder. And those other engineers, yeah, he was weird and ugly too. Very, very prieto, very dark skin. Yeah, Mexicans have an issue with that. But he was intelligent, I could see it. He said something to me and I said something back, and then he said, "You're such a pinga." Now, how do I translate that? Como la niña de la margarita. Okay, there was this commercial with advertising margarina, and there would be this nice little cute little girl, their princess. And she was She would not break a plate. Not one dish she would break. Such a good little girl. And then the margarina came, and the image of that little girl would become really large and her mouth really large. Now she wanted to eat the margarine bread really much. And that's how they used to call me in Mexico. She is so cute, she doesn't break a dish. No rompe un plato. Ya ay. Pero rompe toda la vajilla, princess. But she doesn't break a dish, but the entire chinaware. Because I was daring. I am daring. So what? I don't hurt anybody. Yeah, people were quite impressed. But, you know, it's not about that to me. It's about, can I give you a little courage to do the right thing? To speak up? To be a real human in person? To be a real human, a mensch, for yourself and all the others? Come on, don't be a licker. Be honest and move forward and do straightforward things. Let's create a better place here. You're part of it. And you too. Well, Coca was, eventually. Creating a better place. Being honest and straightforward. So I talked to this man, or he talked to me. Pinga means, yeah, that's just like that, what I just described. So Tiedemann exiled us, so I had to go now to eat with the workers. Yeah, so what? I do that. No big deal. It didn't matter to me, honestly. I just do whatever that is, has to be done. But the other bitches, they would not go eat anymore. Because I couldn't mingle with the workers, get it? I don't mind. So we drink fruit water. Agua de frutas. And this time, the kitchen, yeah, they would do always the same food. I mean, I would have a circle of this and that and this and that, but they would always introduce this dumb German soup, which was, what was that again? Ugh, totally boring. I don't know why, because it's Siemens. Who wants to like that soup? Never mind. So the boss and his achiching, his helper, and the boss in the kitchen, he was a real ogre. I think he was an alcoholic now that I look back. I don't know, his face. I don't remember his function, but something. Get another kiss. He was feared too, in a way. I don't know why, though. So here I am now sitting, eating. I was sitting with the people from the finance department. Well, Raul and Coca would go there too. And it would be a long table. It was like, I don't know, how many? 16 people sitting. Because Raul was there. I was sitting next in front of Raul and Jacob, I think he was there too, and the other people. Yeah. Oh. No one challenged me. They just looked at me. The German, Mexican. I took a green chili and ate it, a jalapeno. Entire thing in front of them. I don't know, I just felt like doing it. Yeah, fortunately, it wasn't really that spicy. I don't know, they saw I have balls. I wasn't really planning on it, but it just happened. They respected me for that. Because I was with them, I didn't felt I was like better than they. I didn't have to pull out an attitude like the bitches who would just stop eating, man. I was with them as a person. And that one day, the fruit water, el agua de frutas, the sandia, the watermelon fruit water was perished. So what the heck? How many people were sitting here? 200? 300? And he gives us that shit. And I was told he does that often. He does that often? Yeah. Or was it, I would have said, the piña, ananas, pineapple? I don't know. He does that often? Wow. So I took the entire jug and I walked to the kitchen, but I actually had to walk. And that was like one of those movies through the entire dining hall on my side. So everybody saw it. So kind of rounding was in the hall. Ooh, literally people would completely be flabbergasted what I would be doing, because in a way the boss over there, the kitchen boss, he had kind of declared war to the people, and they had to stick it in. And as good Mexican Catholics, they did stick it in, but I'm not Mexican, not Catholic, and I don't stick anything in. So I went to speak up for the people. I took the entire jug of water, I walked to it demonstratively, maybe I put it in front and I said, this water is perished. You have to give us good water. You cannot give us shit, man. Yeah, maybe the boss in the kitchen, maybe he bought cheap stuff and pocketed money. Or maybe not. I don't know. But I took also a sample. Okay, good chemist I am. I took the sample and I brought that sample to my boss, to Kenan. And I put it in front of Kenan on his desk, right in front of him. And I said, the water has perished. You have to do something, Kenan. And then I set it down on his desk and I said, go try it. Yeah, I said that. Literally. He looked at me in awe. I don't know, maybe because I spoke up, because I said something, because I would not talk. Why would I talk? All these years, two exact, there's nothing to say. Yeah, maybe I said good morning, as we do, maybe no. He would get his beverage, his coffee, of course, he didn't have to ask. And then he would call me in, I would sit, now he would, I would do whatever that is he told me to do. There's no talking involved. So suddenly I said something, maybe that was in you. And did that change? I feel that was like shortly before I left the company. Did their water ever got perished again? Did he said something? I don't think he dared not to. In a way, he had to say something. Get what I do for my people. I put everything straight. So everyone respected me because I'm a good-hearted person. Get it? And Kunit wasn't. So when Kunit would go on trips, I had nothing to do. He would travel to Europe, to South America. And so I remember that he had an English teacher, a pocho. Oh, that's when I learned about the word pocho. Pocho meant, it's whatever that was. A very tall young man with very dark skin again. So a pocho arrived. And now I would take his lesson because I had nothing to do and he would be there and it was paid for. So I said, I take the lesson, let's go. So I went into Kunit's office, which had a little table, like a conference room, right? And I would talk with the pocho. I don't know if I actually just talked with him. Maybe he spoke with me in English. And that was the lesson. But he would tell me stuff again. I got those things. People tell me things. I wouldn't be lazy as sitting on my desk, self-complacent. I would be doing stuff, I would be learning, I would be forwarding myself at all times and at all moments. I give an example.
And those he plays never suspect. He doesn't play for the money he wins. He doesn't play for respect. He deals a card to find the answer, the sacred geometry of chance. Love.